everything in human experience, and really human history or human civilization's experience, is that everything seems to fall to the earth. That if you have water particles, they don't just, if they're large enough, they don't just float up. They don't, if they're small enough, they're being held up by the wind and all of that. But if they're large enough, they will fall. That you don't have people that are able to just float around, they'll fall. You don't have taxi cabs that float around, they'll fall. And not only will the water fall, it'll hit the ground, it'll puddle up, and if there's a gutter, it'll fall into the gutter. It's just trying to get lower and lower and lower. Or if I were to drop a bunch of needles, they would just fall. They don't, if I have a needle at rest here, it doesn't automatically for no reason all of a sudden jump and or fly upwards or start to float. And so this is a thing that's just fundamental to everything that we've ever experienced. And so for most of human history or human civilization, we just accepted it as a given. We thought, well, look, that's just obvious. Everything should just fall down. That's just the way the universe is. To think otherwise would be crazy. And that's why this guy right over here is one of the greatest geniuses of all time. And he did many more things than just the things I'm going to describe in this video. Each and in any one of those things would have earned his place in history. But this, as you might already know, this is Isaac Newton. Isaac Newton. Easily one of the top five minds in all of human history. So a pretty fascinating dude. And one of his big insights about this whole things falling down problem is, do they have to fall down? Is this just something that we should assume about the universe? That if things just need to fall down? And he says we're told that he did tell people that he was somewhat inspired to come upon this way of thinking by observing an apple falling from a tree. It's probably not true that you'll see in some cartoons on TV that the apple hit his head or hit his head while he was sleeping and gave him the idea. But if most people were to see, let me draw a tree here. That's a twig right over there. Maybe I'll draw some leaves. And let me draw the apple over here. So this is the apple right over here. So for most people, if I were to kind of snap this twig right over here, it's completely common sense. The apple would fall. And if most people were to observe that, they would just think it's a normal happening in the universe. But for Isaac Newton, at least on that day when he observed that apple, he says, well, you know, why did that apple fall? And this, to some degree, is a great example of out-of-box thinking. Because something that for thousands of years, or tens of thousands of years, human beings had taken for granted, just because that's the way it always was, he actually asked the question, why? Does it always have to be that way? And that question took him down an entire line of reasoning that set up the basis for all of classical mechanics, which for the most part we still use today. It's been tweaked a good bit by this gentleman in the last 100 years. But for most purposes, when we're engineering things or dealing with things on the surface of the planet and we're not going close to the speed of light, we can still use the mathematics that Isaac Newton came up with from this simple question. And not only was he able to kind of think that there's something that might be pulling, somehow acting on this apple, bringing it to the earth, but he actually formulated an entire, I guess, law around this thing. So as you can imagine, the thing that Isaac Newton believes brought the apple to the earth is gravity. And he formulated the universal law of gravitation, or the law of universal gravitation, either way. And in it, he theorizes that the force between two objects, and it's a vector quantity, it's always going to attract the two objects to each other. So the direction is towards each other. The force of gravity between two objects is going to be equal to this big G, which is really just a number. It's a number, and we'll see in a second that it's a very small number. Maybe I'll write it there. This is a small number. I'll give you that number in a second. It's equal to this constant, this universal gravitational constant, which is a super duper small number, times the mass of the first object times the mass of the second object divided by the distance between the two objects, the distance squared. So this is distance between two, between both of those two objects. So if you're talking about the force of gravity on Earth, this right over here, you'd pick one of the masses to be Earth. So this mass over here, if you were talking about on Earth, you'd pick one of them to be Earth. This is the object that's on Earth, maybe it's me. And then this is the distance from between the center of masses of both of those objects. So between the center of me, and I won't go into the detail of that, I'll make a more detailed video on center of masses, and the center of the Earth. So it's roughly the distance from the surface of the Earth, or if I'm about 5'9", about half of that distance of, the distance from my belly button about to the center of the Earth is this number right over here. So right when you see this, before we even talk about me and an Earth, or needles and Earth, or taxi cabs and Earth, and that force of gravity, something bizarre might be raising up in your brain. You might say, wait, the way gravity is defined by Isaac Newton, or this formula that we're given right here, it's saying that we have gravity between any two objects. And you're saying, look, I'm looking at a computer screen right now. So you're looking at a computer screen right now. And let me take my best attempt at drawing this is an old school computer, not a flat panel, but gets the job across. So you're looking at a computer screen right now. How come you aren't attracted to the computer screen? How come it doesn't fly into your face? And the answer there is that this number is really small. And there actually is some force of attraction between you and the computer. It's just that it's more than overcompensated for the friction between the computer and the desk, the friction between you and your seat, and which is frankly being caused by the force between you and the Earth, the force of gravitation, the force of gravitation between the computer and the Earth, that both of you and the computer are such small masses that you really can't notice it. It's really negligible. It's being overpowered by other forces that are keeping the computer from even drifting into your face, or your face drifting into the computer. So just to get a sense of that, this G, this unit, this big G, this constant of proportionality, just to get a sense of how small it is, this is, and I'm going to round it here, it's 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11th newtons, and we'll talk about newtons. Newtons is the metric unit of force. Newton meters per kilogram squared. Or actually, let me write it this way. Newton times meter per kilogram. Meter per kilogram squared. So it's a strange set of units here, but the units are really there so that when you multiply it by two masses, which are in kilograms, and divide it by a distance, which is in meters, you will end up with newtons. But I want to make it clear that this is a super small number, 10 to the negative 11th. If I were to just write 10 to the negative 11th, it would be 0.0. And then we would have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. This is, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So this number right here is the same thing as 6.67 times this thing over here. So this is a super small number. And that's why when you multiply it by not so large numbers, if you don't use Earth, if you use you and a computer, you're going to end up with still a super duper 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 small force, something that's so small you won't notice and it's going to be overpowered by other forces, so these things don't fly into each other. But when you think about really massive bodies like the Earth, the force of gravity starts to become noticeable, very noticeable. And I'm not going to give you the mass of Earth in this video, although that's interesting and you can look it up yourself. But if you put in the mass of Earth right over here, if you put it in right over there, and if you put in roughly the distance from the surface of the Earth to the center of the Earth, therefore r, and you multiply that times g, all of these terms right over here, so this term, if you multiply that term times that term and divide it by this term squared, they simplify to what's sometimes called little g. Little g. So this right here, you could view that as the gravitational field at the surface of Earth. It's also the same thing as the acceleration of gravity near the surface of the Earth. And this is, and once again, I'm just going to round it for the sake, this comes out to be units-wise 9.8 meters per second squared. And then you're left with just the other mass. So times m1. So for simplicity, if something is close to the surface of the Earth, the distance does matter, but if we're close to the surface of the Earth, we can say that the force of gravity is going to be this little g thing times whatever the mass is that is close to Earth. So if for example, you were to take me, and let's say I weigh 70 kilograms. So in the case of Sal has a, actually I shouldn't say weigh, I have a mass of 70 kilograms. I have a mass of 70 kilograms. Weight is actually a force, but we'll clarify that more later. My mass is 70 kilograms. Then we can figure out the force that the Earth is pulling down on me, which is actually my weight. So in this situation, the force is going to be g, which is 9.8. meters per second squared, so it's 9.8 meters per second squared, times my mass, which is 70 kilograms. Times 70 kilograms. And let's get my handy TI-85 out to figure this out. So I get 9.8 times 70. And that gives me 686. So this is equal to 686 kilogram meters per second squared, kilogram meters per second squared, or this is the exact same thing as this, the same right over here. This is the definition of a Newton. So this is a Newton, which is appropriately named for the guy that's the father of all of classical physics. So my weight on Earth, which is the same thing as the force that Earth is pulling down on me, or that the gravitational attraction between me and Earth, I should say, is 686 newtons. Now I will ask you an interesting question. So here is Earth, and I am not even a speck of a speck of a speck on Earth, but for the sake of simplicity, let's say that this is me. I'm hanging out in the Indian Ocean someplace. So that is me. And we already know that Earth is pulling down on me with a force of 686 newtons. Now my question to you is, Am I pulling on the Earth with any force? And am I pulling on the Earth with a larger or a smaller force than it is pulling on me? And your gut, or just your knee-jerk reaction might be, well, look, Earth is so huge, Sal is so tiny, clearly the Earth must be pulling with a greater force on Sal than Sal is pulling on the Earth. Unfortunately, that's not the case. So the Earth is pulling on Sal at 680 with a force of 686 newtons, and Sal is also pulling on the Earth with a force of 686 newtons. So Sal is also pulling on the Earth. It makes me feel very powerful with a force of 686 newtons. But you might say, wait, that doesn't make sense, Sal. If I have a building over here, and if you were to let's say, jump from the building, the force of gravity is going to be acting on you, and you're going to start accelerating downwards. It doesn't seem like the Earth is accelerating up to you. Wouldn't we all notice that every time someone were to jump off a building if the Earth started accelerating in a major way? And the way to think about that is the force is the same. And we'll touch on this in more detail in other videos. But force is equal to mass times acceleration. So when we're talking about 686 newtons in terms of the force that Earth, the gravitational attraction between myself and Earth, and this is going to be equal to 68 kilograms, then it provides a pretty good acceleration on me. So in this case, if you solve for a over here, you're going to get the 9.8 meters per second squared. Now, if you do the same thing for Earth, I already told you that we're pulling on each other with the same force, 686 newtons. But now, if you want to figure out how much is the Earth accelerating from that force, you're going to get a, I won't even put it here, you're going to put a huge number in here, huge number, times the acceleration of Earth towards me. And since this is such a huge number, very, very, very large number, this is going to be an immeasurably small number, super, super small number. And frankly, it's probably averaged out by the acceleration of Earth to, or the force of gravity between Earth and all the other people and things on the surface of the planet. So it all averages out in the end. But even if it didn't, even if I was the only thing that the Earth was interacting with, it would be negligible. You wouldn't even notice the acceleration of Earth towards me, but you would notice the acceleration of me towards Earth because of our vastly different masses, even though we have the same, even though the force of attraction is the same.